So I'm going to start off by positioning this talk basically in reference to basically the concept note, as well as some of the discussions that were had yesterday. So I just want to sort of say lay some of the groundwork for the way that I was thinking about the concept note, what the conference is about, and the kind of response that I'm basically giving to it. So when I read the concept note, rather than this discussion of the non-human or human or agency or something along these lines, which is broadly what this is about, and I will be speaking on that topic as well, what struck me most was this question concerning speech. How do we speak about these things broadly, whether it's the Anthropocene, whether it's the non-human, whether it's the human, so on and so forth, and these sort of broad categories. So that impetus around what we, or how do we speak, basically, is what I'm framing this, the entirety of this sort of presentation basically through. And what struck me is that there's a necessity for talking about expression, or how do we express, not even just we, that's sort of a royal we, let's say, as a caveat. But how do we express broadly rather than speak? And that sort of is the question that is basically driving this paper and some of the parameters that I'm going to be talking about. It may wind up a bit morbid, as we do end up at a place of death. However, the sort of end goal of this, let's say, is to point out that aspects of sort of closures or ruptures or something along those lines don't necessarily entail a certain kind of, a certain kind of fundamental temporal closure. So part of framing for this is to talk about a little bit about sort of horizons and so on and so forth. But anyway, that's just sort of the driving parameters with which I'm working through. So talking about expression first and foremost. And as you can see in the title, we'll be moving through, I'll be talking about what exactly do I mean by the term bespoken, as well as this sort of notion of exigency, which ties up into vitality or vitalism. And I'll put in an additional caveat that this is also a work in progress. I'm debating getting rid of this extra little title here on Escha-Ontology, and more focusing specifically on these parameters. But nevertheless, if you just sort of bear with me as I work through aspects of these out loud with everybody. So just to sort of, let's say, preempt the next section where I'm talking about epigrammatics, I want to sort of put this in the framing of the discussion yesterday. And this is principally related to the first two presentations. And I'll circle back to these again, but there was a number of terms that were used, basically. There was one fundamental term, in many respects, that was used. And this was the term life. And so we had phrasing like the fragility of life, talking about non-human life, or forms of life, or what is this, pressed for life, something along these lines, right? So there's a kind of parameter that was set here in terms of a discussion that is formulated through conceptualization of life. And as a corollary or as a direct result of that, or as I'll sort of lay out, we also had utterances that consisted of things like we are rushing headlong into something, or we are pressed for time. So there's a kind of speed that is operating, or exigency, as I'll frame it, in these types of discussions. So those are the sort of overarching parameters that I'm looking into. So I'll start with the epigrammatic work. By the So these are basically the way, the three sort of quotations that are pinpointing what I'm going to be discussing. So the first is drawn from Husserl's work in the Cartesian Meditations, which is a significant quotation that is brought up in Merleau-Ponty's work. And the line goes, the beginning is pure, and so to speak, still mute experience, which now is the issue brings a pure expression of its own sense. I'm just gonna let that sort of sit there. I'll refer back to it a couple of points in time, but it's one of the guiding lines to keep in mind as I carry on. The second is a quotation from Derrida in No Apocalypse, Not Now, Full Speed Ahead, Seven Missiles, Seven Misses, the discussion basically on nuclear war, or the nuclear age. So this goes, at the beginning, there will have been speed. And one of the things to keep in mind regarding this particular quotation is the verb tense that he's using here. He is basically recircling this. So we have these first two quotations that are talking about beginnings. The beginning is the pure, so to speak, still new experience that we need to bring to the pure expression. But if we adhere to what Derrida says here, pulling it slightly out of its context, he writes, the beginning there will have a speed. So how do we talk about, or how do we begin to talk about the relationship between expression and speed, or what I'm going to be referring to as exigency? And the broader framing quotation for the entirety of this is when I was first reading Merleau-Ponty a number of years ago, at the tail end of his work, in the working notes of The Visible and the Invisible, when he's trying to sort of work through what he refers to as an indirect ontology. He unfortunately wasn't able to sort of complete this project, basically. But nevertheless, this is where the sort of ground point that he's trying to work from. Precisely what has to be done is to show that philosophy can no longer think according to this cleavage, God, man, creatures. So these three quotations will distinctly inform the parameters that I am working through. And there's a lengthy history of, let's say, the discussions on the cleavage between God, man, and creatures. This is a distinctly, basically, a largely Christian Western philosophical problem in many respects. But I think Merleau-Ponty sort of rightly identifies this cleavage. And when I get into some of the aspects regarding this, I'll be particularly drawing from Derrida's essay, The Animal That Therefore I Am, in order to position some of this. So these are the sort of the three guidelines here. So we have this beginning aspect. But rather than starting off by talking about the beginning, I want to start talking about the end. So eschatology and apocalypse. This is our framing device here. So very broadly, I'm not going to cover at all the history of eschatology, the history of apocalypse within Western philosophical traditions. But there are sort of three distinctive lines that we can basically see that come through. The most well-known, of course, is the notion of the rapture that's held in the Book of Revelation, and the way in which people, believers, for instance, will ascend, whatever it may be. So there's this kind of, there's an end point, basically, right? There's an end point. There's both a beginning point and an end point within Christian eschatological imagination, formulated through a notion of divine light in many respects. I'm basically glossing over this, I know, but this will set up basically the frame for what we're doing. So we have divine light and this broad, lengthy history of a discussion of something like an apocalypse or something along those lines. Then we move into more contemporary parameters. We jump very heavily here, but I wanted to, when I was really thinking about devising this paper, was to work through Oppenheimer's often cited quotation. It's a quotation that I know, for instance, you learn in an elementary school, basically, when you're in Canada, for instance. And this is, of course, so Robert Oppenheimer is the father, basically, of the atomic bomb. And there's a really interesting discussion surrounding sort of his pacifist background and the way in which or why in which he is working with or developing nuclear weapons. But the famous quotation, of course, that comes from Oppenheimer is when he was at the Los Alamos test facility and uttered a quotation from the Bhagavad Gita where he said, I am become death, the destroyer of worlds. Now there's a lengthy, again, a lengthy sort of critical background in terms of how Oppenheimer was using the Gita, for instance. There's a really interesting article by, James Hillier, which covers this history of how it's used. But I just wanted to sort of frame that, that we have the father of the nuclear age speaking about how he has become death, the destroyer of worlds. And finally, we have Lyotard's basic obsession in his later works, where he talks about the sun exploding in 2.5 billion years, basically. So he frames this, of course, that you know the death of the sun is basically the death of the quest for knowledge. This is like the end, this is the final sort of endpoint of these matters. And if we use this kind of framing, so we have, again, you can see in the way that I put it forward here, light, glow, burning bright sun, these are a kind of, a certain degree of ascension or transcendence is put forward within it. However, let's say when we broadly think of the term apocalypse or eschatology, this is has a sort of a central core around what we would consider a kind of rupture, right? This is a rupture in the general way of doing things. It is an endpoint, it's a teleology. There also has a particular conception of time that works with it. So we have an end, a very sort of distinctive kind of endpoint within, let's say, Western philosophical imagination. And this, of course, correlates with contemporary discussions to a certain degree on climate change, extinction level events, and all of that kind of framework, which is wonderfully elucidated by Ray Gracier in the book Nihil Unbound. So if this is our kind of framing, that if the beginning is the, so to speak, pure expression we're trying to bring in some sense, but there is a fundamental aspect of speed or exigency that is involved, and the endpoint, as it were, is formulated through a notion of a rupture or a closure of thinking, for instance, then how can we use, let's say, this endpoint, this teleology, basically against itself? And the way that I'm looking at this is that an apocalypse or a eschatology, or whatever we want to frame it as, is fundamentally about death. Right? This is the death of something. Closure and rupture as an end point, as death. That is the beginning point that I'm thinking through this on. So if we look at the other side of, let's say, the kind of light rhetoric, even if I'm also constructing this kind of light rhetoric at the same time, we can perhaps look at the kind of ambivalent shadow that this rupture, the supposed rupture, puts forward. And this will make sense in a moment, I think, I hope. So in response to aspects of an apocalyptic scenario or an extinction level event, or how do we deal with certain kinds of closures and ruptures and, let's say, little apocalypses as we go along, there's been one fairly large response to this over the last 20 or 25 years. And this is located broadly around what we would call post-humanism. So a response to, let's say, how do we deal with the question of what will come after the human would be one of the first significant driving points, of course, of post-humanism in its infancy, at least. And I've categorized that just broadly under the terminology post-human. This framing actually comes from Babington's article theorizing the post-human. But basically, we can talk about that. The way in which this word is written, the way in which this word is spoken, has a different meaning attached to it. So the first response, let's say, to talking about what comes after the biggest closure, this apocalypse where man dies, is a question concerning what comes after man, in this very kind of banal sense of after the human. One door closes, another door opens. So in this sense, we have what some of you will be largely familiar with, I would hope, maybe not, but let's say the regular way in which posthumanism is put forward, which is again this question of what is a post-human being in this kind of newfound world. So we have a question concerning successor species. Is the human creating its own successor species through a variety of techniques? Are we framing this through a, what are the technologies that we use in order to do that? With the two very large technologies of this being genetic engineering and, of course, questions concerning cyborgification and the integration of technology into human bodies. Of course, on top of that, you have what does this mean, let's say, for what the human is and the responses to that? How does this fundamentally change what we think humanity is? Do we want to get rid of humanity? Are posthumanists and transhumanists basically arguing for a certain kind of genocide? And this has, of course, been explored in a lot of science fiction, these sort of posthuman scenarios, with the British and American schools largely being very pessimistic versus Japanese science fiction being very much more welcoming of certain kinds of posthuman scenarios. We have successor species, the potential of creating our own successor. We have genetic engineering in the way in which we can eradicate disease, potentially. And finally, we have this notion of the singularity. So this was spoken briefly about yesterday, but not under the term. So Rakers Vale, who's a transhumanist, puts forward that at some point in time, human and technology are going to merge, and this is what is called the singularity. So this is basically what I would say. This is kind of popular post-humanism. This is, if you think of the term post-human, this is the kind of version you'll get. Cyborgs, genetic engineering, cloning, cryogenics, nanotechnology, all of these aspects that are largely in response to what do we do, or what can we do to create either a successor species, or what do we do to prevent our own extinction, or what do we do to enhance human capabilities? I'm going to start moving a little bit faster because I only have about 20 minutes left. But so the second aspect of this is the more theoretical aspect. And as was rightly identified, the starting point for this is anti-humanism. This is largely drawn, of course, from the major theorists and philosophers within the Western philosophical tradition in the 1960s. So this is Lyotard, this is Derrida, this is a little bit of Foucault thrown in here, and even going further back to people like Freud, for instance. I'm not going to go through a lot of these parameters, but nevertheless, just to situate this, there is this other side of posthumanism, which is talking about the decentralization of human subjectivity as such, right? So all the ways that we think about the world around us is basically funneled through human endeavors. And this was, of course, identified yesterday, again, when we talk about strained understanding, when we're trying to understand another species, for instance. We're even trying to understand other human beings that do not speak the same language that we do. And then we have a more, so this is kind of a critical take on humanity or the human, for instance, by trying to just decenter it. And then we have a more building version of post-humanism, which is trying to say, okay, how do we reframe all of these debates that we're not getting rid of the human, as it were. Maybe we're getting rid of human subjectivity, but we're not getting rid of the human. And how do we then begin to talk about things like cross-species communication, for instance? So this version of post-humanism offers something quite different than the other two. So we have one based on this kind of notion of transhumanism, this kind of anti-humanist-based posthumanism, and then we have, well, let's call posthumanism, because this is the school that I'm much, well, this is the school I work with, so I'm not biased. But nevertheless, so you have the school of posthumanism, which is trying to really build on all of these questions, even if the starting point is anti-humanism. And like the theoretical discussion surrounding postmodernism, post here means something quite particular, largely drawing from Lyotard's work, that post doesn't signify an after, but signifies more of a working through of what we consider humanism. So this is not, let's say, a wholesale rejection of humanism or humanity, but a trying to work through particular parameters that it puts forward. And what we have as a result of that is, let's say, a large take-up of Foucault's discussion of the death of man and the trajectory that he traces with that, and this bleeds into Derrida's work. You have this reopening of critical animal studies, which has come largely from Kerry Wolf's work over the last 10 or 15 years. Critical animal studies is now becoming an increasingly large field. And my concern, and other people who work from the phenomenological tradition, is to put forward, this is Ted Todevine's rephrasing of Merleau-Ponty's discussion of the natural world, but how do we sing the world in a new key? So he uses the metaphor of a keyboard and the way in which language operates as a way to say that there is a intermingling and embeddedness and entanglement, of course, right, that was discussed yesterday as well, between humans and the natural world. It is coextensive. There isn't a radical sort of cleft or rupture between these areas, potentially. So this is one response that has been given, let's say, to the idea of a kind of closure that is within an apocalyptic scenario. So this brings us back to the question, right, of how do we speak about non-humans, other animals, objects, for instance? What are the parameters with which we can discuss these things? How do we avoid, let us say, an abyss of difference between human subjectivity and other animal subjectivity, or between different forms of human subjectivity and others? And enacting that this kind of abyss is something like a rupture that closes off the lines of communication between these aspects. So the response that I'm basically going to be giving is that we shouldn't disengage ourselves from this idea of an abyss, but rather that is where we should basically begin to rethink these parameters. And the framing for this paper is through the abyss of death. So when we largely talk about how do we speak for another being, in the way that I think about this, we are actually making a much more significant claim underneath that. We are basically arguing that we can only speak to or speak for something that has life. And a way of framing this quite nicely is through Eugene Thacker's work. So he wrote a text called After Life, and he puts forward that there are basically three conditions or three forms of life that we are largely talking about. And we can see the one kind of life that is in operation in the discussions that we've been having. So he offers three forms. So one is political theological, one is biopolitical, and the one that is most relevant to what we're talking about is affective phenomenological. And he writes that basically, that affective phenomenological life is defined as this, quote, life is in this case neither a quality that a body has, nor a vital force separate from a thing that is vitalized, but the priority of immanence in itself, a continuum or network of affects in which individuated subjects are more effects than causes. So this is a way of situating a particular version of life. However, I want to take life in a much more sort of broader kind of parameter, even if this is sort of the basic structure that we're operating in. So going back again to the question concerning non-human life or the fragility of life or some kind of shared vulnerability among living species or discussions of the life world and phenomenology or something along these lines. When we bring in the question of how is life expressed, it almost fundamentally always comes down to a question of speech. How does life speak to us? How do we speak life to other beings, for instance? So this becomes a condition through which all of our discourse around us is structured. So I'll work through, these are the five claims that I'm making regarding life, drawing on, I'll position this through Derrida's question of the apocalypse a little bit more fully as we go along. So we have life as structuring speech. So life structures speech. The way in which we can talk comes down to these parameters, whether they're affective, phenomenological, biopolitical, or political, theological. However, life here is operating under a certain kind of sovereign parameter, which then governs the way in which we can speak. Secondarily, a third on that, life as sovereign speech enforces a kind of speed or exigency on us. We are pressed for time. We must speak now. We must find ways for non-human to speak to us. We have to be able to listen now, right, in this distinction that we made. From that, we have life as sovereign exigent speech is vitality, part of this kind of new vitalism that is beginning to arise. And finally, of course, life without vitality is non-life. These are very cursory claims at the moment that will remain, unfortunately, underdeveloped, but I will be working through a little bit of them. So just to sort of reiterate, life structures speech, life as sovereign governs speech, life as sovereign speech enforces speed or exigency, life as sovereign exigent speech is vitality, and life without vitality is non-life. So we have questions concerning what is non-life or what does non-life include. So we now have non-life as the other side, right, of life. So this is how, the way that I'm seeing this is how death is positioned for life in this kind of, I hesitate to call it a dualistic structure, but or even a binary structure, but even if it is operating under those parameters. But this is, let's say, the way in which life defines non-life as death. So we have non-life lacks speech, and therefore speed. Non-life, lacking both speed and speech, is not sovereign. Non-life, lacking sovereignty, is a closure and a rupture. And non-life as apocalypse is death. So we have, basically, this is just working backwards in the way that life as a concept, let's say, or is operating in the way that I see discourse surrounding how do we speak about other objects or subjects. I think this is largely grounded on the discourse of life as its underpinnings, basically. And this is something that again, Eugene Thacker identifies to a certain degree. It's something that Derrida identifies in The Animal That Therefore I Am, he's the sovereign, death penalty a little bit. And I think this is sort of a way in which we need to sort of tackle this sort of problem. So we have to ask the question, of course, what is speech, what is speed, what is sovereignty, how does all of this function, of course, right? And why am I making the claim that an apocalypse is considered as death? So this is the question that I am posing through all of those things, which I will now begin the process of working through. So what I'm still currently loosely referring to as Escha-Ontology is precisely this, to open the question of expression, not speech, not from a sovereign position of life as spoken and speaking language, but from an abyssal position of death as meat. So So to explain this a little bit, there's a distinction that we make between spoken and speaking speech in Saussure and Merleau-Ponty. And basically, spoken speech is speech or language that has already been said. And speaking speech is a language that is in the process of coming out, in a process of becoming expressible. And if this is, let's say, the way in which language itself is constructed, the way in which expression is constructed in these kinds of debates, then we have a certain degree of a fundamental loss of speech, basically, that is an operation. But the question that I want to ask, of course, is that why do we need to even talk about speech in the first place? Why do these things need to be spoken of? Are there other ways to express than this linguistic logocentrism, basically, right? Taking on Derrida's point regarding logocentrism, phallogocentrism, and carnal phallogocentrism. So these are, let's say, these are some of the parameters now that I'm framing here. So exigent speech of a sovereign life. So the first is to view or to put forward this discussion of life as sovereign, or a form of sovereignty. And I'm using a very problematic necessarily, but also a very basic definition of the sovereign, which is something that commands, even obliquely, or compels people to speak. And I'm including Derrida's discussion of writing and arche writing within this parameter. So even if he rephrases this through a position of looking at writing as the underpinning of speech, or that which comes before this arche writing in the name, that nevertheless, both of these are functioning to a certain degree in a kind of commanding, even if oblique way, or a compelling, that is an operation. This is, of course, a very complicated question within Derrida's work, but nevertheless, I think this provides a way to situate this. And if the life as sovereign is a command to speak or compelling to speak, then we find at the other end of this is a notion of closure and rupture from that which is silent or perceived as silent, right? If you are unable to speak, you have nothing to say, right? Or if we go on the Wittgenstein line that was brought up yesterday, for that which you cannot speak, you must remain silent, right? So is silence here then perceived as this kind of closure and rupture, right? The kind of apocalypse where we're no longer able to speak. And I'll very personally introduce Derrida's discussion of limitrophy here. So just to sort of very briefly to quote from Derrida. So he talks about pushing, of course, these things to their limits. And he argues that a way of talking about limitrophy, or what he refers to as limitrophy, being concerned with what sprouts or grows at the limit, around the limit, by maintaining the limit, but also what feeds the limit, generates it, raises it, and complicates it. Everything I'll say will consist certainly not in facing the limit, but in multiplying its figures, in complicating thinking, delinearizing, folding, and dividing the line precisely by making it increase and multiply. So if a kind of apocalypse, a kind of silence, which we can potentially also discuss as a kind of death, is the limit of this sovereign compelling someone to speak, sovereign as life, compelling speech, then Derrida would, of course, push this to its limits and see how things are nested around those limits, how they're sort of generated and upheld by it. And the position that I want to take here, again, is that Derrida does not go far enough in this discussion. He puts these things and talks about abutting onto an abyss, or the abyss between, calling each abyss between man and animal, or something along those lines. But in fact, we need to begin to think of this from this position of an abyss. what, how does it function, how does it operate? But if we're carrying on with this format of exigent speech of a sovereign life and the way that this conditions our discussions of expression, we now have, of course, life as speech. Life must be spoken. And there is an inherent, of course, bias embedded within that, right? The only mode of realistic or shareable, communicable, understandable form of expression is linguistic expression, verbal expression to a certain degree. So this places an emphasis or an overburdening on speech and the way in which again we're compelled or almost commanded to speak for ourselves and for others, rather than looking at alternative forms of expression that can come through in when we begin to look at the other side, let's say, even if this is a problematic pseudo-binary that I said. So linguistic expression becomes a problem. Third, well, I'm going to be introducing this concept of bespeaking, and the reason why it's particularly chosen. So bespeaking the non-human and bespoken death. I'm going to use these two terms simultaneously. So when we think of something that is bespoken, right, it is motley, it is put together very quickly, right, under an aegis of speed, right? And it also has a certain degree of nonchalance to it, right? Think of, I'll use a clear example from yesterday, right? Talking about the speaking the non-human, right? We were all outside by the fountain having dinner, and the dogs that shared the space with us were being shooed away by the guards and the people who were doing it. So this is, in a sense, creating this kind of very nonchalant dismissal of these non-human beings which share the same space that we are in. And this moves into a discussion that when we talk about this kind of nonchalant, motley, quickly put together way of approaching the non-human or other animals or something along these lines, we have this sort of very, I would almost argue, very flippant discussion or oscillation between Zoe and Bios. It's a very traditional way of putting it, but nevertheless it works to a certain degree. So you have Zoe, which is the sort of root word for the parameters, for like a kind of real life, and then you have Zeos, which is a kind of bare life, following Agamben's work. At least that's the way that I'm interpreting it. So if speech correlated with speed, correlated with the way in which sovereign works has life, all of these construct a form of vitality, which the non-human or the animal or the natural world, whatever you want to call it, lacks a form of vitality because it cannot be spoken in that sense. And of course, bespoken or bespeaking is something that is done very quick. So we just have a sense of exigency in the way in which it works. So now we turn to Derrida very briefly. I'll have a few more minutes left. So in No Apocalypse, Not Now, and he's talking about the relationship or the way in which how writing operates and how a mythal operates within the sort of parameter of the nuclear age. To sort of tie this back into the kind of apocalypse that Oppenheimer, used Oppenheimer to begin to pull. So there's a particular parameter that's involved in the nuclear age. And it is kind of ironic in the way, at least the way that I'm reading it, the way that he puts this forward. But nevertheless, we can still use this as a basis. Right? So instance, just as all language, all writing, every poetic performative or theoretical informative text dispatches, sends itself, allows itself to be sent, so today's missile, whatever their underpinnings may be, allow itself to be described more readily than ever as as dispatches in writing, code, inscription, trace, and so on. That does not reduce them to the dull inoffensiveness that some would naively attribute to books. It recalls, exposes, explodes that which in writing always includes the power of a death machine. So we have a distinctive kind of linking here that operates between the that which receives a missile, basically, and those who read a book and having the same fundamental power in writing. It is almost a kind of apocalypse. There's both kinds embedded here. And this comes to a discussion of expression, principally, let's say, if we're looking at, again, the way that that expression was framed in the very first session yesterday. And we have this discussion of a call to and a response, right? So the sending of a missile, right, necessitates a kind of response. The sending of a missive, as it was, necessitates a kind of response. And there is a potential problematic in the middle of that when a sending of something, which is a calling for, for a response, is viewed through a kind of reactionary lens, right? There's not a time taken to respond to something, but rather there is a reaction to it. So how this correlates with speech is that speech and our viewpoint of looking at linguistic expression is essentially writing a kind of apocalypse, or speaking a kind of apocalypse under the framework of rupture and closure. And this is, again, pulling it from its context. But this is a point that Derrida introduces in No Apocalypse, Not Now. And he has this little section where he talks about speed as a phenomenon of the nuclear age, and speed is the beginning of his speech. So I'll quote here. He says, "There will have been speed." But again, keeping in mind the verb tense that he's using here. "There will have been speed, but of course, speed was only a beginning for my speech act today." So the way that I'm interpreting this sentence is that he's putting forward a direct correlation between the parameters of speech and exigency and this kind of compelling to speak that is underlined by the notion of the sovereign, which then pulls back to this notion of life as this kind of broad underpinning. Right, so this is the last section, the last bit here. Okay. So how do we then talk about what I'll vaguely call eschatology? I'll say vaguely because I think there might be a better way to conceptualize it than through this. But the way that I was thinking of eschatology here was that we begin from this ruptural point, this perceived ruptural point, and work our way back. We work our way back through the construction of silence as death, through the apocalyptic scenarios that are presented or so-called presented by abysses between objects and things and people and so on and so forth, to install ourselves in that as our fundamental beginning point. So if this whole parameter actually works, and death is correlated with the apocalypse and our rhetoric surrounding the Anthropocene, or whatever we want to call it, is based through a discussion of life, although there are other interesting parameters that have been put forward, most notably by the new nihilist group that is operating, and people like Eugene Thacker, and alternatives from underdeveloped philosophers like Alexius Maynam and Anil Doran. But nevertheless, if we're offering one of these kind of eschatological parameters, and life is conceiving the non-human or nature without speech, and is therefore dead, or something along those lines, dead in this very robust sense, dead in the sense of silent, then we find that a potential way of or the potential way in which the non-human or the natural world has been constructed. This would be like against people like the Romantics, against people who use this kind of sort of beauty aspect or something along those lines who wish to describe nature, or even against people who describe it in a morbid sense, for that matter. But there's a kind of monologue or aside that has been going on next to our forms of linguistic expression and speech that changes the way in which we can think about expression. So this is what I want to refer to as the perennial soliloquy of the non-human or nature. These are asides that are being made constantly, but because they're silent, ergo they're not speech, they are basically fundamentally operating under a form of death. So I'm not saying we need to begin to listen to these alternative forms. What I'm saying is that these alternative forms present us with the opportunity to reconceptualize what we mean by expression, one that is not under sovereign parameters, the parameters of linguistic expression or speech, one that is ultimately not under the parameters of life, but begins from this position of death and the abyss. And there's been some work already done on this, in terms of what we consider expression, non-linguistic, non-verbal expression. And this is largely found in, at least in the way that I look at it currently, is in Merleau-Ponty's work, drawing on this question, how do we bring things to pure expression of their own sense? And what are the ways in which we can do that? So Merleau-Ponty develops a gestural theory of language and phenomenology of perception, and points towards non-linguistic forms of expression. So these are some of the more generalized ones that we are familiar with, right? Hand motions, walking, gait. That would be, let's say, considered under this form of gestural theory of language and non-linguistic expression. But my ultimate point here is that expression is a much more expansive parameter when we no longer view it under the auspices of life or sovereignty or speech or exigency. These parameters of life have done a disservice to the way in which other animals, other humans and non-humans and so on and so forth express. So this would be to cultivate where I want to go to something like an abyssal silence, and talk about the way in which abysses function through a kind of silence. You can see the irony, right, in the way that I'm talking about this, because I have to put this into verbal or written, i.e. linguistic forms of expression, even if I'm saying we need to talk about it. We need to talk about silence, right? So this is almost like a distancing, let's say, from a certain kind of language. So the way that I want to sort of, I'll just conclude now, in that this notion of silence or the abyss or alternative forms of expression, non-linguistic, gestural, creative, so on and so forth, have a tendency to be colored over by a kind of sovereign speech of life that ties everything back to what is this doing for life? How do we talk about vitalism? Which has a kind of internal speech, this kind of exigency, which forces on non-human, other humans, the natural world, whatever we want to call it, a kind of validity that they're not expressing themselves. And this is a fault, basically, of direct ontologies and direct epistemologies. This is a point, again, that was brought up yesterday. And if we draw from Merleau-Ponty, we can see that there's a kind of indirect way that we can potentially get into this, but I'm glossing over that. And so again, there's a kind of, it forces, so this sort of exigency of life forces a kind of forcing a kind of expression that is not what these things are doing, basically. So as I said, it kind of functions, or the way I want to conclude here is that it rather functions through a kind of lexical sadism, right? It forces these things. Life forces the dead to speak. And we need to not necessarily listen to the dead in that sense, but to just look at the different kinds of ways in which expression is put forward. So in the name of life, it does damage and causes harm, because that is basically what a sovereign does, what life does. It commands and compels us to speech, leaving no room for silence. But in the expression of death, we find this kind of silence. It's a kind of positive becoming that we stumble upon. And this kind of positive becoming that we can begin to see will come through more when this exigent speech of the sovereign is no longer tied to a particular kind of tongue. That's where I'll leave it there. So thank you very much for listening to me.